of today's webinar. If you have any queries and questions, you may easily drop your questions in the comment section. Our speaker for this session will be Professor Diwakar Tiwari. Professor Diwakar Tiwari is a professor in the Department of Chemistry, Mizoram University. He received PhD degree from Banaras Hindu University. Before joining Mizoram University, he was working as STF Fellow in National Institute of Materials and Chemicals Research, Japan, and Research Professor in the Department of Environment and Disaster Prevention, Guangdong University. Moreover, he is a visiting professor in the Department of Environmental Engineering, Catholic Guangdong University, South Korea, and went to South Korea as a visiting professor more than 10 times. He has published over 100 research articles in highly reputed journals, and he has been invited as keynote speaker in many conferences in India and abroad. He is the chief editor in Science and Technology Journal and editor in Environmental Engineering Research. Moreover, he is the International Editorial Advisory Board member of Applied Chemistry for Engineers, which is a Scopus Index journal. 10 students received degree under his guidance. Now, let me welcome Professor Diwakar Tiwari to have his presentation.
Thank you, madam, for your kind introduction. Thank you very much. So, first of all, I would like to say thanks to Dr. Dongtia, who has invited me, or the organizers, those who have invited me for delivering a lecture in this international conference. Thank you very much. I am privileged of delivering a lecture despite of all my tight schedule. I told him that definitely I will, I'll deliver a lecture, and I'll be very happy if any sort of help is required, or any sort of assistance is required from our end, that we will be very happy to share with you. So thank you very much in organizing such a international event at that remote place in Champai. I have been there once, so thanks a lot. I would be discussing today, related to my research and all that. So I'll be sharing my slides, and then we will move slowly. So I'll be talking today about, this is one of the area in which we are working. We are working in a different area related, of course, to the environmental remediation and all that, especially the contaminated water and all that, wastewater treatment and all that, in which Dr. Dongtia also, he did a lot of work. I will be showing some of the things. So I'll be talking today about the role of advanced materials in the remediation of aquatic environment contaminated with emerging micropollutants. For this particularly, I'll be talking today the use of the silver or the gold nanoparticles with the titanium oxide nanopillars in advanced oxidation process. We'll be talking something related to the advanced oxidation process and all that. Before I start, I would like to share some of the things. Okay, so this is my profile. You might have seen on my on the website Google Scholar. So we'll be having the more than 3008, the citations with the H index of 32 and I10 index of 70. And this is one of the paper I would like to share with all of you that was published in 2012. 2017, it was the top cited article, the impact factor in the applied clay science. The impact factor is around 4 now. So this is especially I would like to share with all of you. This paper was published in the Chemical Engineering Journal in 2011 and 12. It was the top cited paper. Right now, the Chemical Engineering Journal is having the impact factor of 10. So for this work was the, of course, it is the Dongtia work. So he did when he was doing his research with me way back in 2010 and 11, that time he did this work. So this paper was published. And as I mentioned, the impact factor right now is very high, around 10, more than 10. So this is the top cited article. So as he already introduced me, I'm the editor in chief of the Science and Technology Journal. So this journal, why I am showing you that, I welcome all the those who are participating here, or those who are not participating or doing research. We welcome them to publish their articles in Science and Technology Journal. This is UGC CARE listed journal, so take the benefit of this. Twice in a year it is published, and the other two journals, No, that is the environmental engineering research having the impact around 1.6. So I am the editorial board member of this journal, and recently I am the editorial board member, international advisory committee member of this Applied Chemistry for Engineering. Okay, so these are the journals where you can contribute your research outcomes and maybe published. So recently I have just, other than several other books, one book chapter recently we published that is related to advanced materials in the detection of arsenic from aquatic environment, advancement in the electrochemical sensor. So this is the work what we were doing, and we have associated with the Korean group, and we have developed, we commercialized one, you know, the sensor for arsenic detection and all that. So this right now, I will be having one DRDO project under that, you know, we are doing in this particular area, and this Lalmal Swami C is you know, working in that particular area along with another one. So this book is published along with this Lalmal Swami in the Springer. The other review article recently during this lockdown period, we published in Journal of Electroanalytical Chemistry. This is something that I wanted to share with you. So what about my talk today is, we will be, as I mentioned, we will be discussing about the advanced oxidation process, in particular for the micropollutants and all that. So for that particular topic, you know, so I will be, I have divided my presentation into the different categories, I will say. That is the how we have been motivated doing such type of the research, what is the relevance at the moment, and then we'll come to the introduction part, and then materials and methods, how we have synthesized and all that, those materials. What are the certain results what we obtained, and then we'll come to the conclusion. I'll be sharing here some of the my published work, okay, which was published in the 2018 and 2019. Okay, that we published. So that work only I will be sharing with you. Okay, the new work, I am not going to share what the recent work unless until it is published. So this is the motivation, how we have been motivated. If you recall it, okay, you might have seen that a report was published by India Today on September 29, 2015, has attracted the attention in India. Although it was, there was an attention globally, but in India, it was 2015, the attention, okay, after the publication of this article, which was published in India Today. So what they stated that a new study has revealed that endocrine disrupting chemicals, EDCs, contribute to health problems by mimicking, blocking, or otherwise interfering with the body's natural hormones. It was further stated that EDC's exposure is connected to infertility, hormone-related cancer, neurological issues, and other disorders. Known EDCs include, as we all know that, it is the bisphenol A, which has been used, okay, for making these the bottles and all that, these plastic bottles, water bottles and all that, found in food can linings and cash register receipts, and phthalates found in plastics and cosmetics, flame retardants, and pesticides. So this has attracted a lot of attention. And I tell you that these the micropollutants, okay, or these the EDCs, especially the EDCs, the class of the micropollutants, there are the different variety of the micropollutants are there, maybe pharmaceuticals are there, and endocrine disrupting chemicals are there, personal care products are there. So they are entering into the our aquatic environment. How they are entering into the aquatic environment? If you look at that, okay, our the wastewater treatment plants, our wastewater treatment plants are not that efficient to remove all these the micropollutants at that very low level, microgram to the nanogram level, okay. So they will be entering, they are not, or otherwise we used to call it the persistent chemicals. Okay, they are the persistent, they are not degraded at that level in the conventional, say biological treatment plants and all that. So they are entering into the water bodies and all that, and then slowly they build up in the human system or the biological system, and then they are causing the different kind of the problems. So this is the one thing that I wanted to share you. So this was the, you know, the motivation from where we have started on this. So what are the EDCs? If you look at that, the EDCs or the endocrine disrupting chemicals are the exogenous agents that interferes with the synthesis, secretion, transport, binding action, or elimination of natural hormones in the body that are responsible for the maintenance of homeostasis, reproduction, development, and or behavior. This was the, you know, stated by the US EPA, Environmental Protection Agency, by the US. Okay. So what are the EDCs? What are the sources and all that? So EDCs, as we all know that, okay, they are the natural or the synthetic sources out there. So natural and the synthetic estrogens released from the human, animals, and industrials. So this, they are entering into the sewage system. From this sewage system, okay, from this sewage system, they are, this sewage treatment plant. With this sewage treatment plant, aqueous phase or the sludge phase, okay, in the aqueous phase, as I mentioned that our existing, the wastewater treatment plants are not that efficient to remove all these, the micropollutants at that low level. So they come into the aqueous phase. From this aqueous phase, you can see that it will be entering into the surface water. From this surface water, they are contaminating, and then they are coming into the biological system. And if you look at that, the other side, that is the sludge which has been formed. This sludge, once you dispose it, they come into the soil system, okay? And from this soil, the soil interstitial water, and then it comes into the groundwater. And then from groundwater, through this aquifer and all that, they will be coming into our water bodies. Okay, this surface water, again, it is contaminating with this sediment and all that. So this is the pathway, I will say that, okay, the endocrine disrupting chemicals, they are entering. This is, I have taken simply from this, our internet itself. This is the simplest way of understanding the wastewater treatment plant. The wastewater treatment plant, this is contained with, you all know, that there is a primary sedimentation tank, and then aeration tank is there where you are aerating it, and this biological treatment that will be taking, and then secondary treatment and all that, chlorination and all that, through that you will be getting this the treated water. So treated water itself, as I mentioned that, these treated water, the level of the micropollutants is increased significantly in the wastewater treatment plants effluent. Surface water, sewage water, groundwater, or even in the drinking water. The level of the micropollutants in the surface water is in the range of nanogram to the microgram level. So they will be coming. Recently, I have submitted one research project to the DST. We have proposed that the treated wastewater, how best we can utilize that water for the irrigation and all that in a safer manner. So say, for example, for agricultural purposes, if this treated water can be used, so how safe is that water? So that the project that I have recently submitted to the DST for funding and all that. So what our plan is that we are thinking that this treated water with the advanced treatment process, can we make it in a safer way that can be used for household purposes as well as for the agricultural purposes? So for that, we have proposed a different type of the treatment, not the what we will be discussing now. We have proposed a different treatment that I am not going to share with you at this moment, since it is under process and all that. So anyway, this is one of the area that we are looking at, how best we can provide the treated water in a safer manner, that water is not contaminated with any kind of the micro pollutants. This is a global problem, I will tell you that. Throughout the world, this problem people, they are facing, that the micro pollutant, how best we can deal, because they are entering into the, even by the treatment of this water, wastewater, in the wastewater treat, conventional wastewater treatment plant, they are inefficient to remove at that low level, all the, I would like to share with you, most of these, the micropollutants, there is no such guidelines has been laid down by the US EPA that this much is the permissible limit. Similar, like, you might have learned that the heavy metals and all that, there is a guideline. But for the wastewater, for this micropollutant, there is no such guidelines except few, the chemicals. Others, there is no certain guidelines has been made. So there, what is happening that, they are entering, there is no such regulation is there that completely or this much level has to be removed and all that. So this is, so no such guidelines are there, And if suppose pharmaceuticals you are taking, say for example, the pharmaceuticals are coming into the water bodies, and suppose you are drinking or that water, if people are consuming it, what happens? Slowly you are taking, say antibiotics are there. So antibiotics slowly you are taking at the very low level, of course, but the resistance is going to increase in your body. Later, what will happen that such the antibiotics cannot be that efficient when you are taking for a particular purpose. So this is some of the reasons by which, people are concerned that how do we remove efficiently all these the micro pollutants. This is some of the backgrounds that I have taken, some of the pictures that, okay, so micro pollutants, it is anthropogenic or natural substances, or namely, as I mentioned initially, they may be the pharmaceuticals, they may be the personal care products, or maybe the hormones, antibiotics, pesticides, industrial chemicals, etc., called as the emerging, these days known as the emerging micro pollutants. So what I mentioned initially, that no discharge guidelines or the standard, okay, have been okay given, or the standard regulations are there. Okay. What do we call it, the micro pollutants? Because they are at the very low level, at the microgram to the nanogram level, they are present in the aquatic system. That's why it is called as the micro pollutants. The level of micro pollutants is increased significantly in the wastewater treatment plants, effluent surface water, sewage water, groundwater, or even in the drinking water. The level of micro pollutants in surface water is in the range of the nanogram to the micro. This is the picture. You can see that what is the pathway of that. They are coming from, say, if they are, you will be having this healthcare units and all that, from there, the municipal sewage water, it will be coming here. Or if there is a residential, through this septic tank and all that, they are leachates that will be coming into the aquifer, or through this municipal sewage, it is coming into the treatment plant. This is the treated effluent, and this treated effluent is also having, okay, some of the micro pollutants at the low level. And then once it is being used for this agricultural or the other runoff and all that, okay, they will be entering here, or this through this sludge, they will be coming into the soil. And then, okay, if irrigation is or agricultural activities are there, they will be coming, they will, you know, they will take it up, and then it will be coming into the biological system. So this is the, you know, pathway or the cycle of these, the micro pollutants. This is a greater concern these days. Okay, so I'll be focusing on, okay, only few that which we have studied. Say, for example, we have studied some of the, you know, the drugs or the, you know, antibiotics, say tetracycline or the sulfamethoxazole, that we have studied, okay, for this advanced the processes and all that. Okay, so tetracycline, as you know, that it is one of the commonly used antibiotic. Tetracycline is a broad spectrum antibiotic employed in the treatment of bacterial infections such as Rocky Mountain, spotted fever, syphilis and all the pneumonia and respiratory tract infection. Okay, like that, it is being used. Similarly, if you see that the sulfamethoxazole, okay, sulfamethoxazole is one of the widely used antibiotics, belongs to the, okay, sulfonamides group of the antibiotic. This is also prescribed as a synergistic additive with, okay, trimethoprim to treat urinary tract infections and all that. And this triclosan, okay, we have treated this triclosan also. Triclosan is very widely used. Okay, a lot of applications are there. A lot of, you know, for that they are using. So triclosan, yeah, this is, I have taken only from this, the internet only. So antibacterial soaps, this is being used for the toothpaste they are using. Cosmetics they are using. Twice they are using. Furniture, mattresses and all that. Okay, this is linked to the endocrine disruption. This is causing for the endocrine disruption, breast cancer, resistance bacteria, bioaccumulation, aquatic toxicity. Okay, so what they have suggested, that safer option for this, the wash hands with plain soap and water for at least 20 seconds, avoid products labeled and marked, that is there. So triclosan, if you see that, okay, charge hormone disruption. This is the, you know, this picture, you can see that where they are using it. Okay, this is being used for various purposes, triclosan is used. Okay, so but there are the reasons behind it, that how, why this is important. Okay, at even the low level, it need to be, you know, removed. So the antimicrobial drug triclosan, therefore employed as a potential preservative or even as the antiseptic agent, it inhibits effectively the enol acyl carrier protein reductase for fatty acids synthesis in bacteria, blocking lipid biosynthesis in E. coli and promoting a mutation in FABL gene and all that. Okay, so I'll come to the introduction part. This is, we all know about that. This slide, if you try to see that, this is all we are knowing it, okay? If you look at the left-hand side, that the existing problems, what are the existing problems that we will be facing for the global freshwater crisis, the environmental concern, that is the limited freshwater, we all know that, resources and overconsumption, increased level of water pollutants in various forms, rapid rise in industrialization, urbanization, agricultural activities, etc., climate change, limitations of existing wastewater treatments. If you look at that, okay, the total or what the situation, which is, you know, we used to teach in the school level itself, that out of all the water on earth, 97%, that is nothing usable, I will say that, but nowadays in Israel and all that, they are using that seawater also, although it is the high salinity is there. We have also started some of the work then how best we can utilize this type of the water, how we can desaline it, okay, desalination of the seawater. Okay, there are the new materials, you can develop it with that, but at the same time, the question is that it should be the cost effective and all that. But there are the technologies by which they are treating it, okay, they are removing this, the saline and all that, okay, and then it can be used for the agricultural purposes and all that. So that kind of the work, research work, okay, there are the many people they are doing in the different countries and the different areas and all that. Our country also, we are looking into that, okay, how best we can utilize this, the seawater and all that. So what I want to say that only 2.5 to the 2.7, okay, percent is the fresh water, including 1.75 to 2% frozen in glaciers, ice and snow. Remaining 0.7 to the 0.8% is known as the fresh water. That is only, okay, we are using at the moment, okay. So for this, the limited water availability, okay, we have to see that how best you can utilize that water, okay, for the different purposes, for example, agriculture and, you know, drinking and many other things and industries and all that. So that, what I want to say that a search for more effective wastewater treatment, because recycling of the water is an important. So how best we can recycle in a cost-effective manner, okay, and in a safer manner. There are the ways by which we can recycle it, we can treat it, but sometimes it is not environmentally, okay, environment friendly. So we need the environment friendly approach, okay, and at the same time, the cost effective approach. So a search for more effective wastewater treatment systems and or more viable environmentally benign water treatment, the chemicals, okay. So from there, it comes that the advanced oxidation process, okay. I was thinking that from where this has been coined, this word, okay. I couldn't find from where this has been coined, this, the advanced oxidation process, but it is a very common, okay, advanced oxidation process. They are using, you know, the different kind of the oxidant for that, okay. So now look at that. The alternate treatment methods are, there are the various ways by which we use to treat this water, okay. The one is that the coagulation or the flocculation, we used to teach in the, you know, BSc and even in the plus two level. Then there is an adsorption. When we talk about the adsorption, we are like Pudongtia, he did the adsorption related work. There, what our approach was, that our approach was very different. Our approach was that how best, no, the advanced treatment we can make it, or the advanced adsorption process, using this advanced material, how best they can, you know, this can be, it can be utilized. So for that, the advanced adsorption process that we tried, then this membrane processes they are using nowadays, okay, and then the advanced oxidation processes using, okay, the different ways are there by which we used to do this advanced oxidation process. So most emerging destructive method, we call it as the emerging destructive method, where we try to, rather than removing it, remove, of course it is the elimination removal, but it is not from one phase to the other way we are removing it. What we are trying to do, we are trying to degrade it, oxidize it, okay? Say any organic matter, we try to, you know, mineralize it, means that up to the end product, that is the carbon dioxide in that form, okay, we try to degrade it. So this is nothing but we call it the destructive method, okay? So advanced oxidation processes are contained with the different methods, the different ways by which people they used to do. The one is, which is, you know, known as the ozone UV process, okay? UV illumination along with the, you know, ozone, they try to, you know, degrade it. The other process is that the Fenton-like of the Fenton or the Fenton-like process. This is also in my lab. We have already started, we have done a lot of work in this, the Fenton or the Fenton-like process. We have started with the Fenton-like process. Fenton process is nowadays very old process, I will say that. Now Fenton type of the process that we will be doing. Okay, and then we'll come to the electrochemical or the sonalysis. So electrochemical and sonalysis, we have not, we are not doing. But the heterogeneous titanium oxide photocatalysis process, okay, heterogeneous titanium oxide photocatalysis process that we are doing and that we will be discussing today here, okay, in this presentation. If you look at that, there are the many oxidants available. So in out of this, there are the commonly used, I will say that it's not commonly used, but in terms of the oxidation potential, any oxidant is defined as more efficient or less efficient. If oxidation potential is high, that means that they are very efficient in oxidizing things. Okay. Say, for example, fluorine is there. Fluorine oxidation potential is 3.06, highest, I will say. Okay. But there are the fluorine always, you cannot use it. There are the different reasons behind it. Okay. Hypohalous compounds are being formed. That is why it is not much, you know, encouraged, I'll say. And there are many other issues related with the fluorine utilization. The other is that the hydroxyl radical, if you generate the hydroxyl radical, okay, that radical are having the oxidation potential of 2.80, just below to the, you know, fluorine. So this hydroxyl radical is very useful in degradation or the, you know, degrading is oxidizing these kind of the micropollutants. So our interest is that in situ, okay, we try to generate in situ the hydroxyl radical. That hydroxyl radical, okay, can degrade the stable or the persistent micropollutants. So through using, utilizing this, the heterogeneous titanium oxide photocatalyst, okay, we try to generate in situ the hydroxyl radical, okay. And then I will be coming that, okay, what are the difficulties they have encountered and how best we can solve those problems that we will be discussing today, okay. And then how you can make it in a, you know, in a much modified way by which you can utilize it. So the next is that the other one is that the ozone process, ozone, if you can utilize it, ozone is having the oxidation potential 2.07. Hydrogen peroxide, okay, we are using having the, you know, the oxidation potential, which is 1.77, which is much, much lower than the other, you know, the oxidant. So if this also you can use this, you use it. The hypochlorite, okay. This hypochlorite people are using and for your household things and all that, we are using very often, okay. In this COVID time also, we are using too much of this, okay. Sanitization and all that. This is the hypochlorite having the oxidation potential of 1.49. And then the chlorine is also causing for this hypohalous compounds and all that, which is being formed, that is entering into the environment and that causing the different problems. Okay, so this is the introduction part. You look at that, the titanium oxide photocatalysis, how does it work for water purification? You might have seen that titanium oxide being used for a variety of the purposes. A lot of applications are there, but how best we can utilize it for the water purification and all that. So why titanium oxide? I have just, you know, outlined it. It is largely available. Okay. It's inexpensive, not much expensive, non-toxic. Titanium oxide is not toxic. Okay. So high chemical stability. The material is titanium oxide is highly stable. Okay. That can be utilized. So advantages using this, the titanium oxide is a kind of the, you know, semiconductor. Inherent destructive nature, okay. Sometimes we call it the self-cleaning, okay. So that is the, you know, inherent destructive nature. No pollutant transfer is there, okay. It's not being transferred. Ambient conditions, you can use it. It's not that, you know, you have to maintain certain temperature, you have to maintain certain this thing, okay. It's not like that. So under the ambient conditions, you can utilize it. And it may enable you that completely it can mineralize, okay, the organic organic matter to carbon dioxide. So this is the reason that why titanium oxide has attracted, okay. I'll not go in the history of that, okay, when it is started and all that, okay, the Japanese scientist and all who has initially started on this titanium oxide. I'll not discuss on that part. Okay, let us see that how does it work in this water purification system. This is the you can see that, okay, this is the titanium oxide having this, the band gap energy of 3.2 electron volt. Okay, so valence bond to the conduction band. If you are illuminating this, okay, with this, the photons, which is the having the energy less than the 400 nanometers, okay, it may cause for excitation of this electron, okay, and it comes into this, the conduction band. And here this electron is along with this, the oxygen will be giving you the peroxy radical, and this peroxy radical in combined with, okay, the water molecule and will be giving you, okay, the hydroxyl radical. So degradation, so what happens, this, the pollutants, if similarly here in the hole also, it will be giving you this, the hydroxyl radical is being formed, and this hydroxyl radical may cause for, okay, forming this intermediate and then the mineralization of this organic pollutant that will take place. So this hydroxyl radical attacks on this, the pollutant, and will degrade or can oxidize, okay, these the organic pollutants or these micropollutants, what you call it. Okay, so schematic illustration on removal of pollutants, how this, the pollutants are being removed. But there are the certain problems when you are utilizing this titanium oxide. The one problem is that the high energy photons are required. That is mostly in the UV region that is required. So if you look at that, the photons which you are getting, okay, the solar energy, the solar photons, they are, okay, having in the visible region, okay, they cannot penetrate your system, okay, or this is not that efficient using this solar radiations. Okay, the one problem associated with this. The second problem is that the band gap, the high band gap energy, because of that, the UV visible, UV radiations are required. The second problem is associated with this, that, okay, this is the high fast recombination that take place. If it is fast recombination is taking place, this electron again come back to this, okay, and then the process will not be that efficient. So to overcome this, and the third problem, when you are using titanium oxide as a powder, so what happens, there will be a shadowing effect that is reducing the efficiency of this catalyst, okay? So to overcome all these things, we have tried that, we thought that how best we can modify this material, okay, in a better way and in a better, you know, the film and all that in that way, so that the efficiency has to be increased. At the same time, we have to make this whole process more cost effective, in a cost-effective manner and all that. So this was our way we were thinking that it has to be utilized. Look at that, how the methodology that we have adopted for making this, the titanium oxide, okay, thin films and all that. We interested, rather than using the powder, we interested that we will try to use it, the thin films. Thin films, it is a very thin film, okay? It's a very thin, very, very thin film on the certain substrate. Substrate, what we have used, substrate, we have the borosilicate glass that we have used on that. We have aggregated a very thin film on its surface. So what we have adopted, we have the sol gel process we have adopted. Through this sol gel process and the dip coating method, okay, we obtained a very thin film. So what we are going to do, okay, isopropoxide of this titanium, okay, that we have utilized along with this acetyl acetone, and then ethanol, okay, all that we have acetic acid and all that with water, okay. And this is a simple sol gel process in a single, single step process. So the two ways we try to synthesize this titanium oxide. One way is that, in one way, simply by the sol gel method, we synthesize the titanium oxide, the gel. And the other process, what we did, we have added this polyethylene glycol, okay, with this PG, okay, we try to make it in a systematic network of this, okay. This is called as the template method. So we adopted a template method with the help of this template, that is the polyethylene glycol, okay. We synthesized the material, okay, a good network of the titanium oxide has been created, and then we have been made the thin film and all that. So why this PEG is required, template is required, because the systematic, okay, the network can be generated with the help of this, the polyethylene glycol, okay, having a good porosity and all that, say mesoporous and all that, the material that we have synthesized. Okay, we'll see that how the results are coming and all that. So this is the way by which we have synthesized this okay, the titanium oxide thin films, and then once this gel is being formed, okay, so through this gel, it's not a very good gel, it is almost a salt form. In that we dipped our borosilicate glass, okay, and then the film has been formed, and then we have calcined it at 500 degree, because if you go for beyond 500 degree, what happens that the borosilicate glass, it is going to melt. So our limitation was that we have to anneal it up to the 500 degree. Beyond that, okay, so we cannot do it, otherwise it is going to melt. So up to 500 degree we have annealed, and then we will be getting these two thin films, if I name it as the S1 and S2 and all, okay. Whatever we have introduced, okay, you can say that the doping, okay, of the silver or the gold also that we have done, and this doping was done in situ, okay, in situ, this the silver or the gold nanoparticles has been introduced, okay. So what we did, first of all, we synthesized this, the silver nanoparticle, zero valent silver nanoparticles. It was done in a simple way, okay, this hydride, we have used it, okay. Sodium borohydrate, that we have used it. Silver nanoparticles, the preparation, this is a known method, silver sulfate that we have taken in 100 ml of water. And then sodium borohydrate, okay, we have added 0.002 moles per liter, okay, plus 100 ml of water. And then 30 ml of sodium borohydride solution into the conical flask. That means that in this, the silver that we have added, 20 minutes stirring under the cold condition, ice cold conditions that we maintained, and then added 10 ml of the silver sulfate solution drop wise, one drop per second. Then we obtained a very yellow characteristic color, okay, of this colloidal solution of the silver nanoparticles is being formed. But nowadays we are not adopting this method. We are using this, the plant extract and all that, more greener way. Okay, in a green manner, we try to synthesize this, the zero valent silver or the gold and all that. Okay, nowadays we are using this, the extracts and all. So earlier we have used this chemical, okay, sodium borohydrate. With that, we try to synthesize this, we try to obtain this, the silver, the colloidal form of the silver nanoparticles. It's a zero valent and all. Okay, this is going to reduce and all. So what we did further that, okay, the titanium isopropoxide that we have taken, okay, along with this ethanol and acetyl acetone and all that, this is a salt gel process mixed, and 1.3 hours, okay, continuous stirring, then added 15 ml of the nano silver solution which we prepared earlier, okay. Again, the solution mixture was stirred for 1.5 hours, followed by sonication, okay, for 30 minutes. The solution's mixture was aged for 24 hours. This is called as the sol, okay, S1. And with this sol, we obtained silver titanium oxide thin film by the simple, as I mentioned earlier, by the dipping method. Okay, so this is the gold nanoparticles. Gold nanoparticles we have obtained using this trisodium citrate dihydrate. Okay, using this, the citrate, we have reduced it, and then we obtained this, the gold nanoparticles. So gold chloride hydrate, okay, it's taken in water, we have mixed it, and then the trisodium citrate dihydrate 1% solution, okay, 1 gram per plus 100 ml of water was taken, and then 20 ml solution of the gold chloride in a separate conical flask and heated till boiling, okay. You have to, in the silver case, you have to keep the ice cold condition, but in this case, the very high temperature is required, means that the boiling temperature is required. And rapidly added 2 ml of trisodium citrate solution, the gold solution. The solution mixture was stirred continuously at least for 10 minutes. Solution color, you can observe it, turned ruby red due to the formation of gold nanoparticles. Okay, so this is the silver and the gold nanoparticles being formed. Okay, and this gold nanoparticles, in a similar manner, okay, we have introduced with in this the sol gel process. Okay, directly in situ, as I mentioned that. In situ, we have introduced it, the gold nanoparticles, okay. And then what with the sol has been the form, and with this sol, the thin film has been synthesized or fabricated, okay. This is the methodology further which has been adopted. The characterization of these materials, okay, is being, or the, these thin films is being done by the advanced some of the analytical methods. For example, the SEM analysis, okay, CM, scanning electron microscope that we have used, And then XRD, that we try to use it, you try to do it. Okay, X-ray diffraction method, we try to obtain. And then the diffuse reflectance, okay, spectroscopy, that we have done to calculate what is the band gap energy, okay, the synthesized material, what is the band gap energy that has been obtained with the help of this DRS, okay, the data. And then the BT, that is the, okay, the specific surface area was obtained, okay, using this BT. And then the atomic force microscope that has been used to see that how is the surface of this thin film, okay, that was done with the help of this atomic force microscope. And then TEM-EDX data that we obtained, okay, transmission electron microscope. So for this, the powder of this, okay, the, you know, this, what the material which we will be getting, we evaporated it after making the thin film. The sol was evaporated and removed the solvent, and then we have heated it up to the 500 or the 600 degrees C, and then that the powder was used for this TEM analysis or the XRD analysis and all that. Okay, because TEM you cannot do with this thin film. Okay, so now this the methodology further. How this the degradation process we have conducted, the batch experimental data or batch reactor operations that we have done for the different physicochemical, you know, parametric studies by which we try to obtain a kind of the mechanism and all that. Okay, for that, the different pH constant, the effect we try to see from wide range of the pH, we have studied it. Okay, 4 to 10, then concentration range, we have, you know, very low to the very high concentration, 1 to 5 ppm or sometimes up to the 20 ppm that we have done. And then we try to see that the coexisting ions, how they are, because if you are trying to do for the real matrix analysis, real matrix treatment, then the, you know, you have to see that how efficient is your, you know, this method. So for that, we have done the coexisting ions. We have taken variety of the coexisting ions, cations, anions and all that. Okay, so this is much, much high concentration, that is 1^5 that we have taken. So the coexisting ion concentration is 5 mg/L or 5 ppm. Okay, so this is the photoreactor that has been, you know, this is self-assembled only, the photoreactor that we will be having here. We are keeping our sample solution is kept here. Here we are keeping this, the, you know, the UV or the visible lamp or the LED lamp that we try to put it here. Okay, just above to this, around 10 centimeter above to this. And then we try to see that the kinetics data we try to obtain with the help of this UV visible spectrophotometer. The mineralization we have done with the help of this TOC analyzer, which is a Shimadzu we obtained. Okay, and some of the samples we sent for this facility we do not have. These facilities are already in our lab. Okay, so all these facilities are in our lab. We are conducting in our lab. And this for this HPLC, okay, we sent it outside and then we have done that, how much the micropollutant is being removed with the help of this HPLC. So this is the way, okay, this is the methodology that we have adopted. Now let us see that what the results that we will be getting out of this. Let us see that, okay, if F1 and F2, there's a silver based the material, you recall it, F1 is without the template, F2 is with the template only, okay. So these are the two thin films we have, you know, subjected it, which has been annealed at the 500 degrees C. We have subjected it for the X-ray diffraction method. X-ray diffraction method, if you look at this, it looks more like, you know, the amorphous type of the structure. This is the crystallinity is not well, you know, well viewed in this particular the X-ray diffraction method. But if you look at this, okay, this particular peak is some peak. Of course, you can say that it may be the noise. Okay, it may be the noise, but some peak is there. This peak is, okay, is showing that the, you know, anatase phase of this, okay, the titanium oxide, mostly when we are, you have annealed it up to the 500 degrees C, so anatase phase is there, but when you are annealing it, okay, at the temperature of the 800 degrees C, this anatase phase is predominantly converted into the rutile phase of the titanium oxide, okay. So anyway, so there was, when we submitted this manuscript, I still remember, okay, that there was a question that, okay, why not the material is being annealed at the 800 degrees C. So then we have taken the powder and that powder we have annealed it because they wanted to confirm this, the silver presence. Okay, so then we annealed it, the powder we have annealed, we were not much, they were not much interested about the, the titanium, of course, it is there, but they were interested about the silver. So silver diffraction, silver nanoparticles diffraction, they were interested. Then we annealed the powder at 800 degrees C. Then we observed that the, you know, it has converted this, the anatase is converted to rutile. But at the same time, this is the X-ray diffraction pattern that we will be getting. But in this X-ray diffraction pattern, you can see here, these are the, you know, in this region or all this, these are the dominant peaks are because of the titanium oxide. But when we, okay, expanded this region, then this is the plot that we will be getting. Here we can see that all the, you know, very characteristics peaks of the silver nanoparticles has been observed. So this was with this, we confirmed that the silver nanoparticles are available, okay, are there. So with this, they accepted and then it was published and all. So this is the data that we obtained using this X-ray diffraction method. Okay, this is for the gold nanoparticles based the titanium oxide, which is the gold dope. Here again, the similar data we obtained, okay, in this region. The characteristic peak of the anatase phase we obtained here, okay. And then again, we annealed it at the powder, okay. We have annealed it at 800 degrees C. And then we observed the characteristic, the gold nanoparticles peaks has been, that diffraction peak has been observed. With that, we have confirmed that the gold is present there. So these are the some of the, you know, atomic force microscopic images that we obtained. If you look at this, the images, you can see that, okay, the pillars on this, this is the on the surface of this borosilicate glass surface is there on that surface. The thin film has been, okay, formed, but you can see that the sum of the pillars is being formed on the surface. There are so many pillars that you can observe it. Okay, so these are the, what will be the pillar height of this, the titanium oxide level. Okay, so we try to obtain, to measure it. The thin film, okay, showed distinct and spatially distributed pillars on the surface, and the pillar height was estimated around 35 nanometers. Uniform and more regular pillars of titanium oxide were obtained with the silver TiO2, okay, thin film sample. The pillar height was, for this sample, you can see that when you have used the templated method, the pillar height was significantly increased to the 250 nanometers, okay, from 35 nanometers to the 250 nanometers. You recall it, A is without template, B is with the template, the material has been synthesized. And look at this, the root mean square roughness, how the surface is rough, okay. So roughness of this surface, okay. So root mean square roughness and mean roughness was found to be 0.759 nanometer and 0.406 nanometer for these two, the samples, okay. And 14.095 nanometer and 10.640 nanometers for this, okay, thin films respectively, we obtained it. So this is the data that we obtained for the gold nanoparticles. The gold nanoparticles, okay, when you have, we have synthesized it using this template method, you can see that the very, no, the surface is very heterogeneous, okay. The roughness is very high and all that. Let's see that was how's the result. The thin film, okay, gold titanium oxide, as shows, I scattered pillars on the surface. You can see that some of the scattered pillars are there. A uniform pillars are formed with the sample when you have templated a thin film, you have, you know, fabricated. So heterogeneous surface structure is generated. The pillar height is found to be about 300 nanometers. Here again, the pillar height is much higher than the, okay, untemplated synthesis. This indicates that template synthesis of gold TiO2 caused to increase the length of the pillars of titanium oxide onto the borosilicate surface. Okay, the root mean square roughness and mean roughness is found to be 7.314 and 1.33 nanometer for these two, the samples. Okay, so what about the results related to the adsorption, desorption, the nitrogen adsorption, desorption that we have done for these two materials? Okay, we have taken the powder only, okay, not the thin, the thin film. So for that, the results, what we obtained it, okay, this is the template, non-template, and this is the template way we obtained it. Let us see that, okay, adsorption pore size was 5.613 and for this and 5.67, almost the same. Adsorption pore volume is 0.06, 0.01. But here you can see that the specific surface area was here 49.55 and 12.02. And this, that is option desorption isotherm curves are found to be of H2 type hysteresis loop. If you look at that, the physical chemistry book, okay, that confirms the pores are having narrow mouths with uniform channel-like pore network, okay. Moreover, the solid was contained with particles that crossed by the cylindrical channel having non-uniform size and shapes, okay. So anyway, the material is possessed with the mesoporosity, okay. So these are the mesoporous, the materials, okay. Similarly, we obtained the data for this, the gold nanoparticles, the gold doped TiO2 template, and sorry, non-template and the template, and what the pore size, pore volume, and the surface area. Here again, the data shows that the materials are possessed with or having the, okay, mesoporosity. So diffuse reflectance spectroscopic data, we obtained it, as I mentioned, DRS data we have collected, okay. With the help of this DRS data, one can obtain the band gap energy. Band gap energy is a very important parameter. Unless until the band gap energy is in the reasonable, the band gap energy is very high, then you have to utilize this, the UV, the radiations. If you decrease this band gap energy, then you can utilize this visible. So what the strategy people are doing these days, they are trying to reduce this band gap energy by introducing this, the noble metals and all that, okay. And then they try to utilize these materials using this, the sunlight and all that. So for that, I will not go on that much on the theory, okay, is the Kubelik and the Munk theory was employed, elaborated with tau mathematical equation. This is the equation that we used to use. The terms are well defined here, alpha and H representing the absorption coefficient and Planck's constant respectively. A is the absorption constant, nu is the frequency of light, okay. And then the Eg is the band gap energy. We try to obtain this Eg, okay. N is the dependent to possible electronic transitions, having the value 2 for an indirect allowed transition, 3 for indirect forward. And this is all known, okay. So let us see what the results that we will be getting. This is the reflectance data that we obtain, and this is the wavelength. This is the data that we obtain when we have converted into the, alpha. We have converted into the alpha H nu to the power 2, okay, if you look at this, okay, and is equal to 2. From here, okay, we try to use this, okay, this side, that is the Eg, that is the energy, okay. And if you, this is the plot that we will be getting, and if you extrapolate this, we will be getting the band gap energy. So this band gap energy is 3.12 for this titanium oxide, when it is the 2.88 and 2.89 for these two materials, to the two silver doped materials. One is the first one is, this is the first one is nothing but the untemplate, okay, non-template, and this is with the template. So similarly for this gold, we obtained from here, the extrapolating this, okay, we will be getting the 3.12 for titanium oxide and 2.86, 2.87, okay, for these two, the thin films materials, okay. So now you see that the band gap energy is significantly decreased once you have introduced either the silver nanoparticles or the gold nanoparticles. This is the advantage, okay. This is one of the advantage by which I will say that the band gap energy, we have reduced it significantly. Now we can utilize the solar radiations, or you can utilize the visible radiations with the help of this visible or the UVA. We tried with the UVA lamp, okay. UVA lamp rather than UVC, we have utilized the UVA lamp, and then we try to do this, the degradation process and all that. So this is the scanning electron microscopic images that we obtained for these two materials, that is the silver nanoparticles TiO2, the non-template, and the second one is with the template, okay. In both the cases, you can see that fine grains is being formed, and these fine grains, okay, well distributed on the surface of this, the borosilicate glass. Here also a very fine grains has been formed, okay. These are the EDX data. In this EDX data, you can see that the silver peak is well visible here. That means that the silver is introduced with this material, okay. So this is the scanning electron microscope, which we can mention that, okay, fine grains of titanium oxide are very evenly distributed on the surface of the borosilicate glass, making a uniform thin film, okay. Of course, it is very heterogeneous, but uniformly distributed. Okay, so the templated thin film possesses relatively bigger size of the grains. The surface is having heterogeneous in the structure. Well, this is the transmission electron microscopic images which we obtained with using the powder. Okay, with the help of this powder, we try to get the, you know, the transmission electron microscopic images, and you can see that a very good fringes. Okay, good fringes is being formed. Okay, you can see here the fringes very nicely has been visible. So these fringes we have utilized it to measure, okay, the interplanar distance. Okay, and this, the distribution of this, the this is because of this, the silver nanoparticles and all. So interplanar distance of the silver nanoparticles were estimated to be 0.20 and 0.17 nanometer for these two the samples. Okay, this is the STEM EDX data. Okay, elemental mapping, we can say that elemental mapping we have done with the help of the STEM EDX. You can see this is the elemental mapping we have done for the, you know, titanium, then we have done for the oxygen, and then we have done for the silver. Okay, if you recall it, this is the, you know, titanium. With the titanium, lot of, along with this titanium in the same place, you can see that the oxygen is associated, is there. That means that titanium is not in the elemental form, but titanium is in the oxide form. Okay, because oxygen is in this region, lot of oxygen atoms are being, okay, with the mapping we obtained. But at the same time, when we will be doing the mapping for the silver, okay, very distributed, very much distributed in this, the titanium network, you can see this is the titanium network. Okay, in this titanium network, you can see that well dispersed is the silver nanoparticles. Okay, so with this, again, you can confirm that the silver, okay, nanoparticles are being disturbed within the titanium network. Okay, this is the second sample, templated one. Okay, here you, this is the titanium, this is oxygen. Again, we confirmed that the titanium oxide is there. And then here you can see that the silver is distributed within the titanium network. Out of this titanium network, you can see that very hardly, very few, okay, the silver element is seen. Okay, so that way we can say that that silver is well dispersed within the titanium network. Okay, so with this we have confirmed that the silver, the nanoparticles of the silver, okay, reduced silver is being distributed on that. So this is for the semi images we obtained, okay, for the what you say that the gold nanoparticles, gold doped the titanium oxide. Here again the fine grains is being formed. These fine grains are evenly distributed, okay, on the surface of this, the what you say that borosilicate glass. So what we have written here, the small size particles of titanium dioxide are uniformly dispersed on the substrate surface for both the solids. Titanium dioxide is forming a heterogeneous surface structure on the surface with no aggregation. This is one of the very important thing that I would like to share you, that whenever we are synthesizing this titanium oxide, okay, it is aggregated. Okay, and if it is aggregated, then it may not be that efficient. So aggregation is not that good. So that's why we wanted a good network of this titanium oxide. So this is the TEM images. Here again, we obtained a very good fringes of the images. And with that, we have calculated the interplanar distance, which is being found as, okay, has been found to 0.14 nanometer and 0.20 nanometers for these two samples, untemplate and the template, the material. Okay. So here we will be, we are trying to get, okay, the TEM EDX data. Here again, we have seen that the gold is well dispersed within the titanium network, okay, that we obtained it, and oxygen is associated with that. Now we'll come to the, you know, use of these, the nanoparticles, okay, use of this, the material, the thin films in the remediation of the water contaminated with the drugs, the antibiotics, which is, you know, like the tetracycline or the sulfamethoxazole. Okay, so it was published in Journal of the Environmental Management, okay, in 2018. The paper, this paper is, you know, published, and in fact, I think it is more than four at the moment. So this is the results and discussion we have, you know, as I mentioned that the, you know, wide range of the physicochemical parametric studies that we have done. So here you can see that the removal of this, the you know, these two, the drugs or the antibiotics. So percentage removal, say tetracycline is there on the right hand side. This is a sulfamethoxazole. So what we have done to make a better understanding of how this is going to remove. So we have calculated the percentage species. Okay, so tetracycline based on its acid dissociation and all that. Okay, so we have seen that the tetracycline molecule is having the different species. So we have written it as the TC, TC negative, TC negative, and the TC double negative. Okay, so all these that these species we try to get it with the help of this the percentage speciation. Okay, percentage species. Similarly, sulfamethoxazole. Okay, we try to obtain it. So this is the distribution, okay, of the different species of the tetracycline. On this axis, we have taken the percentage removal by changing the pH. So the two parameters are there. The first parameter is that the species distribution, how the species are distributed. In the second parameter, what we try to obtain is that the percentage removal of that particular species. Okay, so this is, you can see that if you are increasing this, okay, the pH slightly increasing this, okay, the removal here, we have this data is showing that we have not used any thin film. But these two data, we are using the thin film F1 or F2. F1 means that the non-template, this is the template one, okay? Using this, the silver-based the materials, okay? So you can see that there is a big difference, big change or big increase in this when we are doing this, the photocatalytic process, okay? Only photolysis, very little removal we have observed. But when it is the photocatalytic, okay, when you have used this catalyst, significantly it has been increased. More than 70-80%, almost 80% has been removed. Out of these two, we have observed that, okay, the template or the thin film is showing relatively more removal than this, the non-templated one, okay? So based on this, the mechanism and all that, we have proposed it, okay? Detailed study, you may get it in my this published paper. And here is the sulfamethoxazole. Sulfamethoxazole also, you can see that almost a constant removal we obtained, okay? Wide range of the pH from the 4 to the 10 pH, okay, almost a constant removal is being observed. One important thing is that, okay, photolysis is not that efficient, but when we will be doing this photocatalysis, okay, very high removal of this sulfamethoxazole has been observed, almost 80% has been removed, okay. So this is we varied the concentration of the micropollutant or these drugs. We have increased the concentration from 1 ppm, okay, or 1 microgram per milligram per liter to the 20 milligram per liter, okay, and then we try to see that we have observed that increasing this concentration, you can see here, the increasing the concentration, what is going to happen, the percentage removal is going to decrease, okay, a percentage removal, but the content of the removal may be much higher, but the percentage of the removal is going to decrease for this, the tetracycline, and similarly sulfamethoxazole, we observed that increasing this, but here again, you can observe that the photolysis is not that efficient, but photocatalytic is much, much more efficient, okay, comparing to the simple photolysis. And out of these two, you can observe that, okay, we have observed that the thin film synthesized by, okay, the template method showing better efficiency than the non-template synthesized material, okay. So this is the data related to the mineralization. Mineralization, ultimate goal of for any such kind of the studies is that how much is going to be mineralized, okay. So that we try to do with the help of this POC data, okay, or the NPOC data, non-purgeable organic carbon data, okay, we obtained it. And this data, if you see that we have converted into the percent removal, okay, based on this percent removal, you can see that, okay, of course, with the increase in the concentration, so percentage removal is decreasing, but at the lower concentration at 1 ppm level, very high mineralization has been observed, okay, for this tetracycline or for the sulfamethoxazole, okay. This is the, this is a very important thing that I would like to share you, that the repeated use of this thin film, as initially I told you that if you are using this silver or gold, it may be the cost, it may not be the cost effective. That I wanted to share you that it is the cost effective. Why? Because here we are not using the powder. If you are using the powder, okay, large amount of the material is required. But here we are using a very thin film. Very, very less quantity of the titanium oxide or silver or gold is required. Gold itself doping is very less. And then with the thin film, it is much, much lesser than that. Second thing is that how many times the materials or this thin film can be used? How stable is the thin film? That we try to see. So what we did, we have done the sixth cycle of the operation. Okay, we try to do the same thin film after completing the in the reactor. First, the treatment, we have used this and then we have taken it out and then we washed it with the simple distilled water, dried it. Okay, and then again you reutilized it. So that is the repeated operation we used to call it. So this is the say first cycle, second cycle, third cycle, fourth, fifth, sixth. Okay, you can see that with the repeated, this is for the sulfamethoxazole, this is the tetracycline. Okay, so the removal is almost unaffected for the six repeated cycles. That means that, okay, our thin film is highly stable. Okay, for this particular purpose, you can use it for a very long period. Okay, so then what I want to say that it will be much, much more cost effective than the other materials. Okay, this is the studies that we have done. The selectivity is a great problem. Still, we are also working on this, that how do we make the materials more selective? Selectivity is a great problem still, okay, which is unanswered, I will say that. Many studies, many people are doing in this particular area, but selectivity is a biggest challenge, okay. In a real matrix implication, this is a biggest challenge. So we try to do with a large number of the, we have taken the coexisting ions, say sodium chloride, sodium nitrate, copper sulfate, cadmium nitrate, zinc chloride, glycine, oxalic acid, EDT, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. Now you can see that this is the blank data. In this presence of these, okay, there is a decrease. Okay. In particularly, you can see that EDTA, okay, in presence of EDTA, it has much decreased. So percentage degradation of tetracycline or sulfamethoxazole coexisting ions is presented. It was evident from the figure that the presence of these ions affected differently, okay, in the degradation of these two antibiotics. Okay, so this is the area where we have to see that how do we make a very selective, okay, how do we make the material, okay, in such a way that it is efficient even if the coexisting ions are, of course, the coexisting ions are very, very high concentration that we have taken here. Okay, so these are the studies that we have done, because for publication they want that what is the mechanistic aspects, okay, what the exactly is happening there. So what we wanted to see that whether this hydroxyl radical is involved or not, that, okay. So for that we have done this scavengers, which is scavenging the radicals, okay. So for that we have taken the three, okay, the two propanol, NaHCO3 and NaN3, that is the two propanol, okay. And they are the hydroxyl radical, okay, scavengers, and the singlet oxygen sodium azide along with EDTA, which scavengers, okay, the holes in titanium oxide. So in presence of these, you can see that two propanol, the percentage removal of tetracycline was significantly inhibited. The presence of EDTA greatly suppressed the percentage degradation that we have seen earlier. This eventually confirmed that the hydroxyl radicals are predominantly involved in the photocatalytic degradation of tetracycline or sulfamethoxazole, and the whole was involved in generation of the hydroxyl radical. Okay, so this is the way by which we try to explain it. Okay, this is the titanium oxide. Okay, this is the silver nanoparticles has been introduced here. Say UVA illumination. Okay, what is happening? Electron is being excited. So, okay, from valence band to the conduction band, and with here oxygen, and in presence of the H2O, peroxy radical is being formed, and that followed by the hydroxyl radical. This hydroxyl radical, okay, degrading this, the tetracycline or sulfamethoxazole, some byproducts might have been formed, but which has not been detected. Okay, but it is mineralized as well. So that may be into the form of this carbon dioxide or the nitrates and all that. Okay. So it is ultimately the significant amount of this, the tetracycline or sulfamethoxazole, is being oxidized. Okay. It's being mineralized. So this hole also, in presence of this oxygen and H2O, again giving us the hydroxyl radical, this hydroxyl radical again disrupting the, you know, the pollutants. So there is another, the mechanism that LSPR, that LSPR is the other possible pathway of degradation, was perhaps the silver nanoparticles absorbs the UVA radiations, and a local electromagnetic field was generated due to the LSPR, okay, local surface plasma resonance. This resulted the local excitation of the titanium oxide with the generation of the electron and hole pairs. Hence, this simultaneously, okay, this is simultaneously taking part, okay, this electrons are moved here and then forming this, the, you know, the peroxy radical, and this peroxy radical on the surface of this, okay, peroxy radical generating again the hydroxyl radical, and this hydroxyl radical, this is called as the LSPR effect, okay, surface plasma effect. So with that, okay, this is enhancing and then, okay, restricting this recombination of the electrons to the hole, okay, from the conduction band to the valence band, by which, okay, you can suppress this, okay, the recombination and all that. Okay. So with this, the presence of the silver, so there are the, you know, the two aspects which is important. The first aspect was that the, you know, this the presence of this silver reducing the band gap energy. Second aspect is that, second, you know, advantage is that due to this LSPR effect, okay, this is more efficient, and you know, suppresses it, this is going to suppress the recombination and all that. Okay, so this is the one set of the data. The other set of the data that we have obtained for this silver nanoparticles using this, the thin films, the triclosan, we tried to remove, and this paper is published in the Environmental Technology Journal. Okay, and this is the triclosan data, as I mentioned initially, that on the, you know, both the speciation studies as well as the removal studies, the data that has been obtained here on the right hand side, the concentration dependence data that we obtained it. Okay, and this data has been presented at the percentage removal as well as the C by C0. C0 is the initial concentration, C0 is the concentration, that C is the concentration with the, okay, with the initial concentration of the triclosan. You can see that with the increasing the pH, slight decrease is there, okay, of the triclosan removal. Okay, so here these are the data that we obtained it, and here is the, you can see that the concentration, with increasing the concentration, percentage, okay, removal is being decreased. So this is the mineralization of the triclosan for the repeated use of the thin films. So UVA thin film, thin film F1 and thin film F2, this is the only photolysis. This is the, with the help of the catalyst, the two catalyst, one is the, you know, one is the template one, other one is the non-template. Template is giving better results, better removal and all that. This is the data that is the number of cycles that has been, you know, has been carried out. So here the almost a constant value, it looks very sharp decrease, but it is not the sharp decrease. If you look at the, you know, percentage removal, here is the 39% and here is the 38.2. This value is the 38.2. Okay, 38.3, it will be somewhere around 38.3. So almost a constant value that we will be getting that with the number of cycles we have operated in the reactor. So you can say that the thin films are quite stable and you can utilize it for the number of cycles. Okay, different, so many times you can utilize it. So this is the presence of the coexisting ions and the scavengers studies that we have done, as we did earlier also. Okay, for using the different types of the coexisting ions and then the scavengers. In presence of these scavengers, we have observed that, okay, a significant decrease we have observed, okay, we have recorded. That means that the hydroxyl radicals, okay, are being the major, the radicals which is involved in the degradation of this. So now we try to do the removal of the sulfamethoxazole and triclosan as well. This paper is already published in Environmental Science and Pollution Research. Okay, so this data, using this, the gold nanoparticles based the materials or the thin films, and along with this, the tetracycline is also done. So that data, very quickly I would like to share with you. Okay, here is the effect of the pH, how this pH is affecting in the removal of this. So you can see that, okay, increasing this pH, the sulfamethoxazole or the triclosan, okay, all these two data has been included here, sulfamethoxazole and triclosan. So this is going to, you know, with increasing the pH, slightly decreased, but it's not that much decreased, and the speciation is also being included here. On the right hand side, that the percentage removal of the tetracycline that we have obtained here is the, you know, the wide range of the pH. But here what we observed, that increasing this pH, a slight increase of the, you know, in case of the tetracycline, the percentage removal is increased. But at the same time, if you see that the phytolysis is much, much lower, the removal that we have observed, okay, comparing to the photocatalysis. So this is the concentration dependence data that we obtained, increasing the concentration. We have increased the concentration, okay, from 1 ppm to the 20 ppm level, okay. And then the two materials, that is the gold non-template and the template material that we observed, we have taken. So in these two thin films, the templated one is showing the better efficiency comparing to this. And this is the photolysis the results. And on the right hand side, you can see that the removal of this sulfamethoxazole that we have done. Okay, so this is the data that we obtained, increasing the micropollutant concentration from 0.5 to the 15 milligram per liter or ppm has caused significantly the decrease in percentage removal of both the micropollutants, that is the sulfamethoxazole and the triclosan that we have included here. Okay, so this is the repeated use of the thin films. Okay, here is the thin films has been used for the tetracycline. So tetracycline removal for this, the sixth cycle of the operation, here again, it is not much decrease, almost a constant value that we will be getting, that has been done at the tetracycline concentration that we have taken 5 milligram per liter, and the pH was maintained to 6. At this conditions, what we observed, that the film was very, very stable. Similarly, we have done for the sulfamethoxazole and the triclosan, and here again the film is very stable. So whatever the studies that we have conducted in all the cases, we have observed that the thin films are very, very stable. And if you compare with the other studies which we have compared also, okay, we observed that the powder material is not that stable comparing to this. Okay, so there may be some reason that the pores might have been, okay, blocked and all that, because of that maybe, okay, is decreased. But in our case, the thin films are very efficient for the repeated use of the operations. Here is the triclosan and the sulfamethoxazole, okay, in presence of the removal of these two, okay, the drugs, using this, the in presence of the coexisting ions, of course, the five times more that we have taken. So the presence of these ions affected to a greater or the lesser extent the degradation of sulfamethoxazole or triclosan. The presence of EDTA and NaNO2 and oxalic acid had caused to suppress significantly the degradation of the triclosan. On the other side, the presence of EDTA affected the degradation of sulfamethoxazole in the photocatalytic degradation process. Okay, the presence of the scavengers that we have done, you can see that the presence of these scavengers, okay, hydroxyl radical. So this is the significantly, okay, you can see that the significantly it is decreased in presence of all these, the scavengers, okay. So these, the presence of these scavengers, 2-propanol, sodium azide and sodium bicarbonate along with the EDTA shown before, showed a significant decrease in percentage removal of sulfamethoxazole or the triclosan from aqueous solution. This indicated that these radicals are scavenging greatly the involved, okay, radical species. Therefore, the removal of these pollutants were greatly inhibited. So briefly, what I can summarize here, okay, for these studies, okay, it is that the photocatalytic degradation of sulfamethoxazole or triclosan followed the two different mechanistic pathways. UVA photons causes to excite the electrons from the valence band to the conduction band in the titanium oxide semiconductor, where the gold nanoparticles traps efficiently the excited electrons at the conduction band. This eventually restricts the recombination of electron hole pairs in titanium oxide catalyst. The trapped electrons are able to generate the superoxide radical followed by the formation of hydroxyl radicals. On the other hand, the hole that is, okay, created in the valence band interact. So this is what I already discussed at the time of that. The second pathway, which is important, okay, the second pathway of degradation is due to the localized surface plasmon effect, okay, resonance effect, that is ESPR effect, which produces the electromagnetic field created by the absorption of photon energy by the gold nanoparticles. This electromagnetic field causes the local excitation of the titanium oxide with the generation of electron hole pairs. Therefore, this enables the formation of hydroxyl radicals, which simultaneously takes part in the degradation of sulfur methoxazole or triclosan from aqueous solution. So this is the some of the data that I would like to to share with you, and which has been communicated recently in the environmental engineering research using the same materials that we have used it. So removal of the mordant orange one using the silver nanoparticles titanium oxide, okay. So this is the effect of the pH that we obtained. This is the equilibrium studies and all that. Here is the removal of the mordant orange one, okay. So this is the what we try to do this time. We have taken the UVA light as well as we have taken the LED light, okay. So UVA light and LED light, when only when we have used it, almost 0% of the removal we observed. But when we have used this, the photocatalyst, okay, you can see this nanocomposite thin film plus LED light, okay, with LED light, we have prompted it, okay, we have increased this, the removal much significantly, you can see throughout this pH, okay. And when we have used this UVA light, it is much, much, much more higher. So what do I want to say that even, the efficiency is, no efficiency we observed when there was no catalyst, but with the help of these catalysts, we have increased using a simple LED light, okay. This is the market available, this LED light that we have utilized it. And significantly, we have increased this, the modern orange one, the removal, okay. But this is much, comparing to this, the UVA light, it is much lesser than that, okay, the efficiency. So this is the effect of the concentration studies that we have done it, okay. Varied the concentration from the 1 to the 20 ppm level. And then you can see that increasing the concentration. And again here, LED light as well as the UVA light, we try to use it. And then without that, okay, also we try to see that only the nanocomposite thin film that has been done. What we wanted to see that our interest, my interest was that, is there any possibility that the on the catalyst itself, the pollutant is absorbed? If it is absorbed, it is not the photocatalytic process. So for that, what we have done in the dark, we try to see that how much is the removal. So there was no adsorption on it. Okay. So this, the removal is almost zero. So that means that this is the photocatalytic process is operative there. Okay. Rather than the adsorption process. And then we have calculated based on the time dependence data, we have calculated the C2 first order rate constant. The disease for the different concentration of the initial concentration of the pollutant, that is the mordant orange one, okay, we have calculated the rate constant values for the UVA radiations or the LED light radiations. So similarly, we have obtained the mineralization data, that means the NPOC data that we obtained, how much the maximum we can mineralize. So it is more than 25%, almost 30% has been mineralized using this UVA light, and more than almost 17-18% is mineralized with this LED light. This is the repeated use of the catalyst, and we can see, you can see that the catalyst or the thin film is very stable, okay, at least for this. So coexisting ions that we have carried out, similar like the previously we have done, and the radical scavengers, and you can see that in presence of the radical scavengers, a significant decrease is there. That means that the radicals, that the hydroxyl radicals are involved there. Okay, so this is the one data that I wanted to share with you, that the real matrix treatment. So we have collected the data, we have collected the water from the Thong River, okay, at a different site. And then we try to see that the, how is the data, what is the quality of this water, okay. So water which is having the pH around 7.6, conductivity was this much, resistivity was measured, salinity also we have measured, oxidation reduction potential we have measured, okay. And elemental analysis that we have carried out using this our AS, what we observed that zinc is present there, 0.535, okay. This is the unit is missed here. So this is the ppm level, milligram per, it is given here, milligram per liter. And then lead is also there, 0.078. And the high concentration of the calcium is there, 2.341. And the iron is 0.198. Okay, at different sites, they have they have collected it. TOC also, we have measured it, okay, total organic carbon, inorganic and organic carbon has been measured. So inorganic carbon is very high, that is 13.94 milligram per liter, and calcium is very high, you can see here, calcium is high, and inorganic carbon is high, that means that the calcium carbonate or bicarbonate is present there mostly. Okay, nitrate is high, okay, like that, the sulfate and all that, they have measured it. So all these data that we obtained, okay, for this, the water sample, the real matrix water sample, and that has been tagged, okay, spiked with our the modeled orange one using this water. And then we try to see that the removal, okay, in the real matrix, how the removal. So removal efficiency is almost similar like, we have done previously with the double distilled water. The double distilled water and this data is almost the similar data that we will be getting. Okay, this is the concentration of the mordant orange and removal that has been measured. So that means that in the real matrix treatment also, okay, when we have used it for the, water which we have collected from the Thuong River, okay, the efficiency of the catalyst is almost similar. So with this, we can conclude that lower pH values and the lower concentration of MO, mordant orange 1, have favored greatly the removal efficiency of the mordant orange 1. Increase in the mordant orange 1 concentration from 0.5 to 20 milligram per liter, the percentage removal of MO1 is decreased from 60 to the 13% and 38 to the 6.5% under the UVA and LED irradiation. A significant percentage of the MO1 was mineralized in single reactor operation under UVA and LED irradiations. Increasing the MO1 concentration from 1 to 20 milligram per liter, the percentage mineralization of M is decreased from 27 to 7. Okay, it's a similar like the previously we obtained. The scavenger studies indicated that the degradation of MO1 is primarily due to the reactive hydroxyl radicals, holes, and singlet oxygen, which are primarily involved in the surface excitations. Moreover, the repeated use of the thin film catalyst showed almost no suppression in photocatalytic efficiency of thin film. Hence, the nanocomposite thin film possesses greater applicability in sustained reactor operation. The real matrix operation using the Ryukyi Sai Thuong River water, okay, showed almost negligible, okay, in terms of the efficiency compared to the distilled water treatment. That means that this methodology or this treatment can be utilized for the real matrix treatment and all that. So this is all. These are some of the pictures which we have taken. Okay. So thank you for your the presence and all that. Okay. For your patience to listen to me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Diwakar Tiwari, for your wonderful and informative presentation. With that, today's webinar has come to an end. Thank you all participants. I hope that you will all join us in tomorrow's webinar as well. Thank you.